Good afternoon, everybody. Yeah, I think I'm coming through. I don't see any wild gestures that things are not being recorded. So please, everybody who's joining our webinar this afternoon, we want to wish you a warm welcome to yet another Creodios Cloudfero webinar. Today, I am going a bit back to basics. Yeah, I've been asked if I could just do a more general talk about Earth observation data. So I will go a bit through the Earth observation principles, fundamentals, and I will in the end highlight some example use cases from our Creodios platform, how we use the set Earth observation data sets. So I warn you, I'm really not going too much into detail. I just want to keep it general for people who are just starting with Earth observation or just generally interested in the data to get to know a bit more about what this data is, what you can do with it, and so on. So don't pin me down on too many technical details in the questions. I can answer a lot, hopefully, this talk is not intended to really go into the nifty grifty technical details of the satellite data. So let me quickly switch to my presentation that I will have to do like share screen, and I will share my PowerPoint, which should be coming up now. I think so. Let me go to the beginning first. Yeah. So let me start with the agenda for today. So I would like to talk a bit about the general introduction into the Earth observation principles, as I mentioned before. Then I would like to spend some time on the Sentinel missions. At the moment, there's four operational Sentinel missions. And I would like to go through each of them because they are forming the backbone of the data sets on the Creodios platform. They are very popular and used in many application fields like agriculture, as you can see the image on the bottom right. Then I would like to highlight the older data sets that we have a bit less in, a bit more general as well. And then I would like to showcase three use case examples. One first relating to air pollution monitoring from the Sentinel-5P mission. Then SEN4CAP software. SEN4CAP stands for Sentinels 4 and the Common Agricultural Policy. So it's agricultural monitoring, which is the software is using Sentinel-1, Sentinel-2, and Landsat-8 data for that. I will talk a bit about that, and then I would like to finish off with showing some VHR, very high resolution imagery that we have available through the platform as well. So let me go into the introduction into the Earth observation principles. Let me start at the beginning. Earth observation sensors are the sensors mounted on platforms, and they all work to work in some part of the electromagnetic spectrum. That can be optical and the optical domain, so optical and atmospheric sensors as well. They usually are operating in the visible, near infrared, and shortwave infrared domains. So that's, if you look at the spectrum image on the top right, it's pretty much in the middle, the visible spectrum, and a little bit to the left of it in the infrared domain. So infrared is also the domain where the TV remotes work. And then with the SAR, SAR stands for Synthetic Aperture Radar. Radar is a longer wavelength. And they are just to the left of the infrared domain. So the wavelengths in which radar satellites operate is between a few centimeters up to, let's say, 1 meter of wavelength. So also part of the electromagnetic spectrum, but just a different wavelength. the waves, the radar waves have different properties and different effects on the return signal to the satellites, which I will highlight later. Then one very important aspect to keep in mind is that Earth observation sensors can be passive, which means that they're only receiving electromagnetic radiation. So that's optical sensors. It's like a photo camera, basically. You don't send, well, you don't send a signal to a camera on your phone or in a photo camera. It's just capturing the light that has been sent by the sun and is reflected on a surface and back to the sensor. In the case of satellites, the sensors on board the satellites. Or sensors can be active, which means that they're both emitting and receiving information or the radiation. And this is the case for a synthetic aperture radar. They send a radar pulse from the satellite all the way down to the surface of the Earth. This signal is then in some way reflected back to the sensor, part of it. Of course, you can imagine that not all of the signal is reflected back. I have to say scattered back officially. In microwave, we talk about backscattering and not reflecting so much. And that signal is then received by the sensor on board the satellite and recorded. And from that, a radar image is built. What's also very important to keep in mind is that, the electromagnetic spectrum is not all transmitted equally through the atmosphere. As you can see on the bottom right graph, the blue areas are the transmittal windows, as you would call that, which shows you that on the left, the scale is the other way around than the top image. So the further to the right you go, the longer the wavelengths are. In the visible domain, there's quite a decent transmission of about 1.0.5, and this is there's a very big gap in the middle, in the far and extreme infrared, where there's no signal attenuated by the atmosphere at all. And in the far right, it's where we're in the microwave domain, there's a very good transmission of electromagnetic waves, which is the microwave domain. This is also very important to keep in mind that, we're really operating in areas where actually signal can be transmitted through the atmosphere. Otherwise, there's no point to have a sensor all the way up there. Then I would like to highlight a bit what kind of Earth observation satellites do we have. I mean, it's a huge range and they're launching loads and loads. Last Sunday, there was a record launch of 143 satellites from one rocket. They were mostly nano and very small satellites from smaller companies, building cheaper satellites and launching them in bigger amounts. But it tells you that there's a lot of Earth observation satellites up there at the moment. Earth observation satellites can be targeted to specific application domains. That can be meteorology is very obvious. There's meteorological satellites, atmospheric satellites, satellites that measure the composition of the atmosphere, for example. But they can also be focusing on urban studies, agriculture, environmental, geosciences, you name it. Then we have the different sensor types on satellites that can be, as I mentioned already before, you have optical. The main categories here are the optical and near infrared sensors. Then you have the SAR, which is the radar satellites, and others. They're also experimenting now with satellites with lasers to perform altimetry. So there's a lot of different sensor types. Spatial resolution is a very important category as well, criterion. Can be low, which can be a few kilometers by a few kilometers for each grid cell size that the sensor can measure. It's mostly for the meteorological satellites. They have a lower resolution. And then it can be higher and to very high. And very high is usually a spatial resolution of less than 1 meter. There's quite a few satellites now up there that can measure less than 1 meter, or let's say 2 meters. And high is in the domains of 10 to 20 to 50 meter square grid cell size, which is the spatial resolution that the Sentinel-1 and 2 missions operate in mostly. Then very important category as well is a spectral resolution. How many bands does a satellite have in the optical domain? This is very important. How wide is the band for each band? What's the spectral domain in which each band can measure? How sensitive is the sensor? I mean, the spectral resolution is a very important aspect of a satellite. It's not all about spatial resolution. A lot of people think the higher the spatial resolution, the better the data, but that's not necessarily true. Then a revisit time is also a very important category for or distinction between Earth observation satellites. Some satellites, they cover a very wide swath, a very wide path in one go, so they cover the entire globe in one day, whereas some others have a very narrow swath and they need a lot more time to revisit the same spot on the globe again. So that can be in the order of weeks, the old Landsat has a revisit time of about 16 days, which is nowadays quite low. The size of the satellite, they can be big, small, or nano. Nano, I think, is less than 10 by 10 centimeters. Small is a bit bigger, and bigger is, this is all a bit relative, these categories, but the size can definitely... it can be very variable. Then constellation, that also is a distinction. You can have a single satellite. You can have like a double, what you often see with radar satellites now, that they fly basically in tandem. There's the well-known Tandem X mission, which is two radar satellites flying just off behind each other. In this configuration, they can do some very interesting measurements on the topography, for example. Or you can have a swarm or a constellation. Nowadays, with these nano satellites, there's a few companies that build very small satellites and they launch them by the dozens in one go. There's lots of them. And then, the ownership, that's one distinction, I would say, with ownership, or maybe I could also name this data availability or accessibility. And there's a lot of commercial providers that provide data that you have to pay for, and there's also quite a few public providers now. Well known as the Landsat missions from NASA and the USGS in America, and of course our Sentinel missions from the Copernicus program in Europe. This is all public data, freely available, can be reproduced, can be used without any limitations. I'm talking a lot about satellites, and what's now the ideal EO satellites? I mean, if somebody would want to design a satellite, doesn't know anything about satellites, what would he or she, there wouldn't be any limitations in what technical capabilities would be. And what would they want? They probably would want a very high spatial resolution, very wide swath width, so that's the area covered in one acquisition, basically the width of the angle in which it looks. A very good radiometric quality, very much cloud-free data, so no clouds, because clouds are usually disruptive. Very cheap data to replace or multiply, the satellite. Yeah, and the data should be very free. Well, does this satellite exist? No, it doesn't, because every satellite is a trade-off between technical capabilities, different user requirements, and available budget, etc., etc. So that's you have this image on the right with a number of different satellites, both commercial and public publicly available satellite, or not the satellites, but data from satellites that either record publicly available or commercial data. And they look very different, but they have all different capabilities, and they usually focus on one or more of these categories. For example, the Maxar Worldview, somewhere in the middle right, that's a satellite from the commercial provider, which offers very high resolution data, less than half a meter, I believe. But it doesn't come for free, and it can only cover a very small area of the world in one go. Whereas, for example, the ESA Sentinel-1A can cover a very wide swath in one day. So every satellite is different and all really focusing on different needs. But usually the best way forward, I always say, when you want to do an Earth observation study, don't stare, focus on one data source only. Try to combine it from different sensors and try to use the advantages of each data set. So you will get a better end result. There's a lot of text here, but there's a few things I still would like to mention, because a lot of people often ask me about these things. So you have a satellite that has recorded data. What are all these different types of data doing, and what are these abbreviations, acronyms meaning? So there's a few things to really keep in mind. There's more data criteria than I have on this slide, but these I think are the most important one. So the satellite, the Earth observation data does. One of the most important one is in terms of data set is in what acquisition mode of on the satellite was this data acquired. For example, here you have the Sentinel-1 IW, EW, and SM acquisition modes. They all stand for different ways to operate the satellite. Sentinel-1 is it can be switched to different settings, the satellite. For example, over oceans, they usually record data in the EW, which is the extra wide swath mode. And over land, it's more the IW, which is the interferometric wide swath mode, so which is narrower than the EW mode. But then you also have the SM mode, which is the strip map mode, which is very narrow resolution. So these are the acquisition mode is a very important parameter when it comes to the data types. And also focusing on what you need, you can select which data type you want to focus on. Then the product or processing level, that's a very important one, because it really depends on your needs, to what level you want to start with. If you're interested in getting the most advanced parameters from satellite data, you're really researching what kind of data, information you can get from a satellite, it's probably more useful to start at a lower level. If you're interested in just getting a nice image of how, for example, a field is growing over season, you can probably start with a higher level data. And that has already been pre-processed to that level where you can easily compare different images from different dates, for example. So level zero is very raw data. Not many people use it. ESA and also NASA, they pre-process their satellite, their Landsat and Sentinel data straight to level one. Otherwise it's very difficult to get started with. Level one is the level that you often get from the providers. So it has been time referenced and geo-referenced, and in sensor units. Level two is often is a level that a lot of people want to use. So often this step from level one to level two is quite a tricky one, but you can see also on Cryodias we provide now a number of processors that process the imagery that comes from the data archives to level two, from level one to level two straight away. So users can easily start working with their level two data. So for example, in optical data, this level one to level two, that means it's an atmospheric correction, for example. Or for Sentinel-1, the radar data is often like a terrain correction and calibration. of the data. So you can, but basically level two means that you can compare one image with another, and you can assume that they will be comparable, that there's no errors due to atmospheric effects or due to terrain effects that might make the comparison invalid. Level three and level four, they are higher levels that are often derived from a workflow or from processing workflows after this. And those variables are often the results. They're really the final results of models that can be used in, for example, further analysis. Then a question I often get as well, which is a product type. What does a product type mean? Well, basically, what it means is that products from one sensor, they can be processed into different product types, serving different user requirements. That's a bit vague, but what it means that data in the same processing level can be processed to different types of data. For example, a very good example is the Sentinel-1 SLC and GRD distinction. SLC stands for single loop complex, so that's the radar signal split into the component for phase and intensity, or power, I should say, which can be used. This type of data can be used for analysis into interferometric studies, so basically comparing one radar image with another and looking at how the phase has changed, which can be used, for example, for mapping of elevation, mapping of subsidence of terrain. But often users don't need to do that, or they're interested in other things. And for that, you have the GRD data, which is, it's the same processing level, but it's just processed to a different level. It's a bit more user friendly already, and we're not looking into phase and intensity parameters anymore, but just at backscatter units already. So that's I can talk a lot about this, but there's a lot of information on the web. Also, if you look at the link below, there's the user guides for all the different Sentinel data sets. I would really recommend to read more. It's a very clear website and they explain it pretty well. The data principles, we're going to the next category, which is the relative orbit, which is very important for Sentinel-1. Especially for the interferometric studies, that satellites fly with a system of relative orbits, and these are basically fixed overpass routes over the globe. So there's about, I think, 200 relative orbits for Sentinel-1, and they're just the path that it flies over. And each Sentinel satellite, there's two of them, Sentinel-1 satellite. Each of these, they fly the same relative orbit 12 days after the previous time. So, the official revisit time of Sentinel-1 is now 6 days, because there's two satellites that fly behind each other. But per satellite, it's 12 days. So, yeah. And then, this is the last one is what I call the basically geographical, the tiles or the path or row system, which means that for Sentinel-2 we have a tile system, for Landsat we have a path and row system, and these they're basically fixed areas on the globe, like square tiles all around the globe, in which the data that's recorded is just cut or cropped into the So if you look at a specific area, you can find a tile code in the Sentinel-2 tiling grid system, and you can all the data is delivered per tile for this specific for every time the satellite flies over. So it's a so it's very easy to know. If you say I'm looking at this tile, you can just search for the data that's there, and then for every time there's data recorded within that tile, the data will be made available for this tile. So then I would like to focus a bit more on the specific Sentinel satellites. Sentinel-1. Let's start at the beginning. There's two satellites, two Sentinel-1A and Sentinel-1B, launched in 2014 and 2016. And these satellites, they operate in C-band, so that's a wavelength of about 20-30 centimeters, if I'm correctly memorizing the wavelengths exactly. In two polarization modes, so in VV and VH mostly, which is the direction in which the signal is transmitted and received. And it's an active sensor, so it sends out a signal which is scattered back, and that scattered the backscattered signal is recorded. As I mentioned already, it's a 6-day revisit time and a spatial resolution can start at 10 meters, but it's usually lower. I mean, with radar, it's not so clear. There's often some filtering needed to make the data a bit, I would say good looking, but to correct for some specific phenomena that you have with radar data. So you can use 10 meter data, but often people resample it or filter it to about 20 meters. So it's still quite a good spatial resolution. So the application domains is, as I mentioned earlier already, terrain mapping, agriculture, forestry, emergency mapping, or polar studies. Yeah, what are the advantages? Well, a radar signal is unhindered by clouds, and that's a very big plus. And also it can record at night because it's an active sensor. It sends its own signal. So if it's dark, it can send the signal and you get information back. So there's much more useful data being recorded than with an optical sensor. It's got a very good radiometric quality and it's got a wide swath. It covers quite a wide area in one go. On the image on the right, you can see already what these different acquisition modes that I mentioned earlier mean. It's just basically looking at the different width of the area that you look at, and either you focus more or less depending on the acquisition mode. Yeah, the disadvantages, what I often hear, is that spatial resolution is not as good as people would want it. They're very big and heavy data sets, especially when you look at SLC data. So you need a lot of resources for processing. And there's still quite a bit of pre-processing needed until you can really use it. Yeah, and the data is a different type of data than optical data. Optical data just looks familiar because your eyes also work in the optical domain. So as a human being, you're very used to looking at optical data. Microwave, so radar data looks a bit, it's different. You look in a different domain, so there's a different interaction with the surface of the Earth, so that makes the data more difficult to interpret. It's a very popular mission actually at the moment, getting more and more popular because of this guaranteed acquisition basically, because there's no clouds, especially in areas where there's lots of clouds like the tropics or Northern Europe. So that's Sentinel-1. Let's go to number two, which is very similar in the sense that there's also two satellites flying, Sentinel-2A, Sentinel-2B, launched just after Sentinel-1 in 2015-2017. This is a multispectral optical mission with 13 bands in visible, near-infrared and shortwave infrared domains. Also a 6-day revisit time. And spatial resolutions are 10, 20 or 60 meters, depending on the band. I think the optical bands in the visible air domain are 10 meters spatial resolution. So it's a very popular mission, I would say. It really provides very good data, very reliable, and it's being used in many different fields, like what I mentioned as well there. Again, agriculture, forestry, there's a lot of interest there. Coastal studies or inland water for water studies as well, but also polar studies. So it's a very wide range, and I can name a few more application domains there, but I just picked a few there. Advantages, as I mentioned already, is that the data, people find the data more easy to interpret, and also it's got a very good radiometric quality. It's just a very well-built satellite, very very good sensors. Disadvantages, clouds. As any optical sensor, there's a lot of clouds. Every cloud is recorded. There's plenty of very advanced algorithms to filter out the clouds to make sure that they are. And these algorithms are getting better and better, but you can't deny the fact that if there's a cloud, you can't see the ground. So that will always be a problem with any optical mission. But depending on where you live in the world, I mean, in warmer latitudes like the Mediterranean or parts of more desert arid like climates, it's very useful. And yeah, what I say is also this there's a lot of atmospheric corrections needed to make sure that the acquisitions are comparable. And atmospheric corrections, they're very complex models, and there's a lot of different algorithms out there, and there's no consensus really which one is the best. So it's sometimes difficult to really calibrate the data. You can really compare one image with another. Then I go to Sentinel number 3, and yet again, there's two Sentinel 3 satellites flying at the moment, Sentinel 3A and Sentinel 3B. And this is a very different mission, in the sense that it's basically three missions in one satellite, three sensors on one satellite. So you have the SLSTR instrument, which is a thermal instrument measuring land and water surface temperature, or basically infrared radiation, or and that's then converted to land and water surface temperature. OSVI is a spectral an optical scanner. It's a bit like a low resolution Sentinel 2, but it's used a lot for global mapping. So not parts of the globe, but really like global mapping. And then you have the SRAL, which is an altimetry measure, which is also a radar, which measures the height. And because it is a very low resolution sensor, it is about the spatial resolution about 300 meters for the OLCI and 500 meters for the SOSDR. It has a very low revisit time, so basically every day it's covering the entire globe, every 1 or 2 days. Application domains, temperature measure, so surface temperature, ocean color as well. So there's a lot of oceanic used for oceanographic applications a lot, in topography or global land cover. It's also a very wide range of applications, also because it's all these different sensors. It has advantages that it has a very short revisit time, very diverse range of applications. The disadvantage is it's a lower resolution than Sentinel 2, basically. But it serves a very different need, this satellite. Then there's one more Sentinel satellite up, the Sentinel 5P, which is it's just one satellite. It's launched in 2018, so 3 years ago. And it's equipped with a TROPOMI instrument, which is a spectrometer sensing in the ultraviolet to shortwave infrared. It's a very low resolution, so 7 by 7 kilometers, and it's looking at atmospheric composition. And it has a revisit time of every 1 day, so it comes over every day, and it's used for atmospheric composition measuring, so number of different chemical components of the atmosphere like NO2, CO, but also aerosols, methane, ozone. It's a different application domain altogether than the previous ones in that sense. But it's very interesting, and it's been popularized quite a bit last year during the first Corona lockdowns, when they could notice or they could measure the changes in air quality over specific areas in the world. So here you can see in the image China, which was a very impressive decrease in air quality when the major lockdown started there last year, March. It's an interesting mission. The advantage again, short revisit time, It's got a wide range of atmospheric components, and there's a lot of well-calibrated products in level two already available, so you can really start playing with the data very easily. Yeah, and it's a disadvantage, the low resolution, but that's the nature of atmospheric monitoring. I mean, there's a, yeah, atmospheric missions tend to have a lower resolution also because the signal they try to catch from the atmosphere, it's a very weak signal, so you have to sample from a larger area to get a better signal to noise ratio. So what's this? And send for cap on Creodios. That's the wrong title there. Anyway, this was what I meant. Here is the other missions that we have on Creodios, not the Sentinel mission. So I quickly go through this. We have Landsat 5, 7, and 8, which is fairly similar to Sentinel 2. It's an American mission. Then we have SMOS, which is an ESA mission, which is a passive microwave scanner, which measures ocean soil moisture and ocean salinity. So it's and it has a very low spatial resolution, but it's a very popular mission as well for global studies. Then we have data from the Envisat mission, which is a very old satellite, which is not active, which I think it stopped working in 2012, so it's already quite, here in 2011, actually. It was a huge satellite, a bit like Sentinel-3, but then much bigger even, with a lot of different sensors on board. But yeah, we have the MIRIS data, which is the same as the Sentinel-3, or the precursor to the Sentinel-3 OLCI data. And also ASAR data, which is C-band SAR, synthetic aperture radar data, a precursor to the Sentinel-1 mission. Then we also have JSON-3 data, which is altimetry data, similar to Sentinel-3 SRL data. And then we have a few satellite data from very high resolution satellites, which I will mention later in the use cases. They're very high resolution, so lower than 1 meter spatial resolution, and they operate in a multispectral domain, visible in the near infrared, and it's commercial data, but I'll highlight these a bit later as well. Then I quickly want to go through this. There's also data that's not necessarily satellite data, but it is often derived from satellites, which is let's say high level two, level three products from different Copernicus service projects. So we have the climate change service, they have the atmospheric monitoring service, the emergency monitoring service, the land monitoring service, and the marine environmental monitoring services. There's a very big archives of data. We don't have them all completely stored on the Creodios, but we can always add more if a user is interested. But I would suggest to read a bit further on these data sets, because quite often data that you would like to use is already available through one of these services, even one of these Copernicus services. And then we have also the ancillary, some more data sets. I again have a different wrong header there. That is the Sentinel-1 orbit data. So we stored the orbit data from Sentinel-1 as well. But we also, and what's more, a lot of people are interested in, is terrain data. We stored a complete archive of SRTM, which is the terrain model recorded in 2002 from a space shuttle mission. It's freely available. We have the MAPZEN data, which is fairly similar to SRTM, but it's expanded a bit into areas where SRTM doesn't cover, and improved wherever the data was available. But that, we have that data as well. And what we start using now, which is start offering more and more, is the Copernicus DEM, which is a more recent terrain model of the world, covering the complete world, so from pole to pole, from the TerraSAR X and the Tandem X missions. We have that available in 30 meters and 90 meters spatial resolution. That's something we are integrating better and better on our platform. So we also would like to offer that as a terrain model that you can use to process other data sets, for example, Sentinel-1 or Sentinel-2 data. And then also one data set that we have is a land cover map of Europe based on Sentinel-2 data, which is the S2GLC. It's developed, it's processed on Creodios, developed by the local remote sensing institute here in Warsaw, CBK PEN. And yeah, that's also available for any user to look and download. Then I would like to round off a bit to the use cases. Some work that I've been doing over the last years or so, just some nice examples of what you can do. So it is been looking into analyzing Sentinel 5P data. But there's a list of different parameters there. But I was looking, I was interested in what's the impact of forest fires on the atmosphere. How can you monitor forest fire emissions, smoke from forest fires from Sentinel 5P data? And so I used aerosol data from the Sentinel 5P mission. And I was looking a bit, if I hope the animation comes a bit through. Last summer, end of last summer in the west of the United States, there was a very big amount of forest fires. And on the animation on the right, you can see through different weeks in the end of August to end of September, you can see how the aerosols, so basically the particles in the atmosphere, were drifting from the west of the United States to the east. And that's, yeah, that I've used a very simple script to download and process this data and build this animation, all with open source and free scripting languages like Python and R. So that's a nice example of how you can visualize, use satellite data to visualize events, for example. And then I have another use case. I've mentioned already this Sen4Cap software. It's a platform that's developed by the Sen4Cap consortium, which is mostly led by the university in Leuven in Belgium. And it's a system in which a user, for example, somebody who's working at the pay agency in one of the European Union member states, or any other person involved in agriculture and would like to monitor what's going on in an area, can be a country, can be a region, they can start a virtual machine, which is on the Creodios platform, where the software is all pre-installed. And then they can start using the software straight away by defining an area of interest, a period of interest. The system will automatically download and pre-process Sentinel-1, 2, and Landsat 8 data from level 1 to level 2. And there's a number of different algorithms available. For example, a crop type mapper, a detection of mowing events algorithm. That can help the user to investigate, analyze the agricultural activity. And here's an overview of the different products that can be generated on Sen4Cap. So the crop type map, a grassland mowing product, vegetation status indicator, and a number of agricultural practices. As you can see there. The platform, the software is still being developed, I think, and we are in good contact with the leader, the developers and the leaders of the consortium. And so any user can easily start using this software without having to install anything, basically. Then the last use case or example, I would say, is this very high resolution data that we have available. We have now VHR imagery from three providers, Yilin from the Yilin 1 satellite, the CASIOSAT and the COMPSAT satellites. And it's a commercial offer, so the imagery can be ordered through Creodius. We don't have the entire archive readily available, but we are building on an integration of their API, the API from the Casio SAT. That's the first one we'll be having ready very soon. So any user can use our API or our data finder to search through the archive, and then can order it through our platform as well. I have to mention that this imagery does not come from free, because it's a commercial offer, so it's an add-on. It's not open and free data. On the right, you can see in a comparison of Sentinel-2 on the top right image in the south of England. This is, and the Yilin-1 area image of the same area. And there might not be very clear on your image at home, but there's quite a distinctive quality difference. So yeah, if you're interested, I would suggest to contact our sales department as well, and they can provide more information. And then I would like to stop with the last example of very high resolution data in action. This is an actual video which is recorded from a satellite, from a Yilin-1 satellite. So it's a satellite manages to capture an area for a specific amount of time. So and puts all the images in a bit of a movie. And the funny thing is, you can see cars driving from space. So I'll play this movie. I hope it works. Yeah, it's coming and it's zooming in. And I hope you will be able to see something on your screens at home. But if you look closely on the major road, there are some bits moving, and that's moving cars. Driving through Beirut. This is that's Beirut. So it's pretty impressive these days what you can do from satellites, I have to say. And this is it's a very good example. So with that use case, I would like to. There we go again. Well, let's do it once more. Hopefully you'll see a bit, manage to distinguish something. But this is the last slide of my presentation. So I would like to, if you want to more further information, please contact our either our sales department, Przemysław Mujta, at email, or for any technical support, send to the email there. And then I have a few more things. I am coming now. I have to highlight it. If you want to keep in touch or want to get more training, there will be more upcoming webinars. So please go to this website there to finish off by saying thank you all for joining this webinar. I hope you learned a little bit. I would like to say this is just a quick introduction that I wrote, but there's loads more to learn. If you have any questions, feel free to reach out to CloudFero as well, Creodius, or on the Twitter, LinkedIn, or Facebook pages that we have as well. And that, from my side, that will be it then. And everybody have a very good day or afternoon or morning, wherever you are on the globe.